Today we are going to discuss about surgical anatomy of tongue. You all know the tongue is a mobile muscular organ in the oral cavity. And we all know that is the only visible skeletal muscle in your body. So that's why it is used in many clinical conditions, even to look for certain clinical signs like fibrillation, etc. So it is nothing but a mass of striated muscles covered with mucous membrane, and of course it is voluntary in nature. With this little bit introduction, just we'll move on to the parts of the tongue. The tongue is divided into three parts. There's a very basic thing. It is divided into three parts. There is a tip, body, and the root. The tip is otherwise called as the apex. The tip is the anterior free end of the tongue, which usually comes in contact with the incisor, central incisor teeth. And the root is the posteriormost part of the tongue. And the root is the most posteriormost part of the tongue. And this root of the tongue is attached to the mandible and the hyoid bone by means of certain muscles. The body of the tongue lies in between the apex and the root of the tongue. The body of the tongue lies in between the apex, the tip of the tongue, and the root of the tongue. If you see the surface of the tongue has two surfaces. One is the dorsal surface and one more is the ventral surface. If you see the dorsal surface of the tongue, it is convex in nature. Let's discuss in detail about these surfaces. If you see the dorsal surface of the tongue, actually this is the dorsal surface of the tongue. If you see the dorsal surface of the tongue, this dorsal surface of the tongue is divided into two parts by means of a sulcus. Can you be able to make out a sulcus here? So it is divided into two parts by means of a sulcus that is called as the sulcus terminalis. So thereby the tongue is divided into anterior two-thirds and posterior one-third. So the dorsal surface is divided into anterior two-thirds and posterior one-third. The anterior two-thirds of the tongue is otherwise called as the oral part. It is otherwise called as the oral part. And the posterior one-third is otherwise called as the pharyngeal part. The posterior one-third is otherwise called as the pharyngeal part. Let's see about this anterior two-third or the oral part. The most characteristic feature of the anterior two-third of the tongue is the presence of papillae. Can you able to make a lot of small projections here? So these are called as the papillae. Okay, what do you mean by papillae? Papillae are nothing but the projection of lamina propria of mucous membrane covered with epithelium. Again, I repeat, what do you mean by papillae? So the papillae are nothing but the projections of lamina propria of mucous membrane covered with epithelium. So these papillae you can able to make out in the anterior two-third of the dorsal surface of the tongue. So that is a basic definition for papillae. So there are various types of papillae. So what are they? They are the valid papillae, filiform papillae, fungiform papillae, and the folate papillae. We'll see one by one. First, we'll discuss about the valid papillae. Just in front of the sulcus terminalis, can you able to make out some small projections which is parallel and as well as in front of sulcus terminalis? These are called as a valid papillae, or otherwise called as a circumvalid papillae. Valid papillae, or otherwise called as a circumvalid papillae. These papillae are nothing but, if you see, actually this is the circumvallate papillae. These are nothing but, it is a truncated cone. You see, it is a truncated cone surrounded by a sulcus. You can able to make out a sulcus here, surrounded by a sulcus and mounted by a wall. Its periphery is mounted by a wall. So this is the characteristic feature of the circumvallate papillae. And it has a unique feature that it can be seen only in front of, in parallel and as well as in front of the sulcus terminalis. Approximately they are 8 to 12 in number. Usually it varies from 8 to 12 in number. If you talk about filiform papillae, they are nothing but a minute conical projection. You see here, they are the minute conical projections with pointed tips. If you see here, you can able to make out the pointed tip here. So they are the minute conical projection with pointed tips. Actually, they are most numerous, and you can able to make out these filiform papillae on the dorsal, almost most part of the dorsal surface of the tongue. They are more in number than any other papillae. And next one is the fungiform papillae. They have a rounded head and a narrow base. You can able to see a rounded head and the narrow base. And these fungiform papillae, usually it is seen along the margins of the tongue and as well as the apex of the tongue. Just now we saw what you mean by apex. You can able to make out these fungiform papillae in the apex of the tongue and as well as along the margins of the tongue. And next one is the folate papillae. The folate papillae, actually they are rudimentary in humans. They are leaf shaped here. You can able to see they are rudimentary in humans. It's not seen always. They are well developed in rabbits. So the major papillae which contributes to the characteristic features of the anterior two-third of the tongue are the valid papillae, that is circumvallate papillae, filiform papillae, the fungiform papillae. Among them, the filiform papillae form the most numerous part. Okay, you can ask me, what is the function of these papillae? Why there should be papillae in the anterior two-third of the tongue? So these papillae contains this very special structure called as the taste buds. These papillae contains a very special structure called as the taste buds, and these taste buds are responsible for the taste sensation, or otherwise called as the gustation. So these papillae are mainly meant for taste sensation. Actually, we know we have various types of taste: salt, sweet, bitter, sour. And now latest, actually they have added one more taste, that is the umami. So that is the taste sensation stimulated by the presence of glutamic acid in certain food types like meat, etc. Okay, so these are the various types of taste sensation. So these taste buds, which are present in the papilla, are responsible to sense the taste sensation. Actually, this picture shows you, previously it was thought that certain papillae and certain parts of the tongue are responsible for the sensation of certain particular taste. For example, if you say previously it was thought the tip is mainly meant for salt, and the margins of the tongue is mainly meant for sour, and the posterior one third of the tongue is mainly meant for bitter. But now it has been proved that all the papillae carries all the taste sensation equally. So that is the carrier message I want to convey. All the papillae carries all the taste sensation equally. So what is this? Actually, this condition, you can able to make out a shiny glossy tongue. So what is the clinical implication of these papillae? So in this, actually this is a condition called as a glossitis. So here you can able to actually what you are seeing is the anterior two-third of the tongue. But if you see the anterior two-third of the tongue, you can't able to make out any papillae at all. You can able to make out a shiny glossy mucous membrane covering the anterior two-third of the dorsal surface of the tongue. This condition is called as a glossitis. Okay, sir. Okay, glossitis. What is the clinical implication? Actually, why we are correlating this now? Actually, this kind of patient, glossitis is one of the, actually you can see it in various clinical diseases. So in this condition, the patient usually present to you with, they can't able to sense the taste at all. That is the commonest symptom they will give you. So why they can't able to taste anything? Because you can't able to make out any papillae. You see here, there is a complete absence of papillae here. So because of the absence of papillae, they can't able to taste any taste sensation. They can't able to sense any taste sensation. So this condition, we call it as a glossitis. So that's why the papillae play a very important role in sensing the various types of taste. And next we'll move on to the posterior one third of the tongue. If you see the posterior one third of the tongue, you can able to make out lot of lymphoid follicles. These lymphoid follicles together, we call it as a lingual tonsil. So the characteristic feature of the posterior one third of the tongue is the presence of lymphoid aggregation. So collectively we call it as a lingual tonsil. All of you please remember, the lingual tonsil is a part of Valdeyer's ring. The Valdeyer's ring is constituted by lingual tonsil, palatine tonsil, tubal tonsil and the nasopharyngeal tonsil. So the lingual tonsil is a part of Valdeyer's ring, a very important lymphatic ring, which is present at the junction of actually the entry of both the respiratory and the oral passage. So the characteristic features of the anterior two-third is the presence of papillae, and the characteristic feature of the posterior one-third is the presence of lingual tonsil. So now we will move on to the vent. So far we discussed about the dorsal surface of the tongue. Now we'll move on to the ventral surface of the tongue. So the ventral surface of the tongue, you see just here, this is the ventral surface of the tongue. So there are three characteristic features in the ventral surface of the tongue. So what are they? One is the frenulum and the lingual veins, the deep lingual veins and the plica fimbriata. So these are the three terminologies you should know whenever you talk about the ventral surface. What do you mean by frenulum? The frenulum are nothing but the mucus fold which connect the ventral surface of the tongue to the floor of the oral cavity. So exactly it is present in the midline of the tongue. And by the side of the frenulum, you can able to make out a set of deep lingual veins. Can you able to see here? Actually, these are the deep lingual veins, which is present just by the side of frenulum of the tongue. Here, actually, this will be the here will be the frenulum of the tongue, just by the side of the frenulum of the tongue. Still more lateral to the lingual veins, you can able to make out a fringed fimbriated fold of mucous membrane. So that is called as a plica fimbriata. So these are the three features you can able to see it in the ventral surface of the tongue. One is the frenulum and the second one is the deep lingual veins and plica fimbriata. Actually, so okay, what is the clinical importance or what is the clinical correlation of these structures? Actually here, you see the deep lingual veins here. The deep lingual veins are just covered by a thin mucous membrane. And whenever it comes in with contact with the floor of the mouth, so there will be saliva. So whatever you place it here for certain drugs like lipid soluble drugs like NTG, nitroglycerin, if you place the drug here, it will be dissolved rapidly by the saliva and it will be rapidly absorbed by these deep lingual veins. Because only a thin mucous membrane exists between the deep lingual veins and the floor of the oral cavity. So you can't make it out like this in any other parts of the body. So this is one of the very characteristic feature where we use that characteristic feature in certain emergency condition like angina pectoris. When the patient is having angina pectoris, you place this nitroglycerin tablet just beneath the tongue, it will be dissolved rapidly and it will be absorbed rapidly by these deep lingual veins and you can see the effect immediately. So that is one of the very important clinical aspect of these deep lingual veins. And one more clinical correlation of this ventral surface of the tongue is a tongue tie. So what do you mean by tongue tie? I told you about the frenulum of the tongue. You see, this is the frenulum of the tongue. If the frenulum of the tongue extends too far towards the tip of the tongue, you see here it doesn't extends up to the tip of the tongue, but here if you see it extends too far up to the tip of the tongue, so this is called as a tongue tie. Okay, so what happens whenever there is a tongue tie? So this tongue tie inhibits the normal movements of the tongue because here the tip of the tongue is not free. So it inhibits the normal movements of the tongue and may interfere with normal speech. But it can be easily corrected by just cutting the frenulum. You just release the frenulum and then you just move the tip of the tongue, actually make it freely movable. That's fine. That is the treatment for the tongue tie. So these are the very important clinical correlation regarding the ventral surface of the tongue. Actually, this is one more clinical picture to show you the tongue tie. You see here, the frenulum extends up to the tip of the tongue. And one more very important clinical aspect of the ventral surface of the tongue is the undersurface of the tongue is a good site for observation of jaundice. Actually, we'll observe jaundice clinically at certain area. One is the conjunctiva of the eye, and one more is the ventral surface of the tongue, that is the undersurface of the tongue. So the undersurface of the tongue is one of the very good sites for observation of jaundice also. So these are some of the very important clinical correlation you should know whenever we discuss about the ventral surface of the tongue. So now we move on to the muscles of the tongue. So regarding the muscles of the tongue, the muscles of the tongue is divided into two groups. One is the extrinsic muscles of the tongue and the intrinsic muscles of the tongue. So please do remember one point I will tell you, just you should not forget, please do remember, the intrinsic muscles of the tongue are mainly meant to alter the shape of the tongue, because whatever we are going to discuss in the upcoming slides, like attachment, action, everything is related to this point only. The intrinsic muscles are mainly meant to alter the shape of the tongue, and the extrinsic muscles are meant to alter the position of the tongue. The extrinsic muscles are mainly meant to alter the position of the tongue, and the intrinsic muscles are mainly meant to alter the shape of the tongue. The tongue is divided into two halves by a median septum, and the muscles of each half consist of intrinsic and extrinsic muscles. Therefore, each half has four extrinsic and four intrinsic muscles. Okay, so now in just actually each half contains four extrinsic and as well as four intrinsic. Now we'll discuss about the intrinsic muscles. So I told you the main function of the intrinsic muscles of the tongue is they alter the shape of the tongue. So obviously the intrinsic muscles will be confined to the tongue itself. So that means, what does it mean? It arises from the tongue and it ends within the tongue. So that is, the muscles are confined to the tongue. That is, they originate and inserts within the tongue. Especially they don't have any bony attachment. There is no external attachment at all. So no bony attachments. So what are those intrinsic muscles? I told you four in number. They are four in number. So they are the superior longitudinal, inferior longitudinal, vertical muscles, and transverse muscle. And the name itself tells you. What do you mean by longitudinal? Means it extends anteroposteriorly. It starts from the tip of the tongue and it ends at the root. So that's what it means. Vertical means it starts from the dorsal surface, it ends in the ventral surface. Transverse means it starts from one end, that one lateral margin of the tongue, and move towards the another lateral margin of the tongue. So that's all about the origin incision. Very simple. You see here, actually here, this is the what section it is. This is the cross section of the tongue. So that is the coronal section here. You see here, in this actually the upper group of fibers are the superior longitudinal. Here the lower group are the inferior longitudinal, and the fibers which are running transversely are called as the transverse longitudinal muscle, and the fibers which are running vertically are called as a vertical group of muscles. So if you points regarding the superior longitudinal, it lies just beneath the dorsum of the tongue. What is the action? What happens when the superior longitudinal muscle contracts? Whenever the superior longitudinal muscle contracts, it curls the tip of the tongue upward. It curls the tip of the tongue upward. You see, just see this picture. Whenever the superior longitudinal muscle contracts, it just turns the tip of the tongue upward. That's what happens whenever the superior longitudinal muscle contracts. What happens when the inferior longitudinal muscle contracts? The exactly opposite action happens. That is, it curls the tip of the tongue inferiorly downward. So whenever the inferior longitudinal muscle contracts, what happens? It curls the tip of the tongue inferiorly or downward. And what happens whenever, actually imagine what happens whenever the transverse muscle contracts? Very simple, when the transverse muscle contracts, it narrows the tongue. It narrows the tongue and it increases the height of the tongue. You see here actually, when these fibers contracts, what happens? Automatically these lateral margins are brought together. So obviously it narrows the tongue. So whenever it narrows, obviously the height will increase. So that's what happens whenever these transverse muscle contracts. So it narrows the tongue and it increases its height. So that's what happens whenever a transverse muscle is contracted. So what happens whenever a vertical muscle contracts? Obviously it flattens. You see, you see this diagram, you will understand. You see, whenever these vertical muscle contracts, what happens? So it brings the dorsal surface and the ventral surface together. So obviously it flattens the surface. You see, this is the action. It flattens the dorsum of the tongue. So that's all about the intrinsic muscles of the tongue. Now you know where it arises, what are the various intrinsic muscles, and what is their position, and from where to where it extends, and what happens whenever these muscle contracts. Please do remember, when you talk about action of any muscles, you just know, you just imagine its origin, where it arises and where it ends, and direction of the fibers. So if you remember all these things, it is easy for you to write the action of that muscle. Okay, now we'll move on to the extrinsic muscles. I told you a very important point when you started the muscles of the tongue, that is, extrinsic muscles are meant to alter the position of the tongue. So whenever you want to alter the position of the tongue, obviously the muscles which alter the position of the tongue, one end should be attached to the tongue. Obviously the other end should be attached somewhere away from the tongue. Then only when it contracts, it can alter the position. When you alter the shape, there is no need for any external attachment. But when you want to alter the position of the tongue, definitely you need an attachment away from the tongue. So here, force structure gives attachment to the muscles that moves the position of the tongue. So what are those four structures? One is the mandible, and one more is the palate, that is a soft palate, and stylite process, another one, and one more is the hyoid bone. So these are the four structure that gives attachment to the extrinsic muscles, that is the mandible, soft palate, stylite process, and the hyoid bone. So in the mandible, which part of mandible gives attachment? Superior genial tubercle. So the muscle that extends between the superior genial tubercle and the tongue, we call it as the genioglossus, that is a genial tubercle. So we call it as the genio and glossus. Glossus means tongue. So the muscle extends between the genial tubercle and the tongue. So it is called as a genioglossus. Similarly, the muscle which extends between the palate, soft palate, and the tongue, so it is called as the palatoglossus. And one more muscle between the stylite process and the tongue, so it is called as the styloglossus. And one more muscle between the hyoid bone and the tongue, it is called as the hyoglossus. So these are the four extrinsic muscles of the tongue: genioglossus, palatoglossus, styloglossus, and the hyoglossus. And you just see the position of these muscles. That is very, very important. Direction of the muscle fibers, that is also very important. You see here that mandible is located just in front of tongue. So it is located just in front of tongue. So whenever the muscle that arises from the mandible contracts, automatically it pulls the tongue forward. So the contraction of these genioglossus produces protrusion of the tongue. So the action is over now. Now you know the attachment first, and now the action is over. So when these muscle contracts, it pulls the tongue forward. That is protrusion. Similarly, if you see the hyoglossus, it arises from the hyoid bone to the tongue. It ends with the tongue. So whenever these muscle contracts, what happened? It depresses. Where the hyoid bone is located? It is located below the tongue. So obviously, whenever the muscle contracts that arises from the hyoid bone, what happens? It depresses the tongue. So the depression of the tongue is produced by the hyoglossus. And you see the styloid process, where it is located. It is located behind and a little bit above the tongue. So it is mainly located behind the tongue. So whenever these muscle contracts, obviously it pulls the tongue backward. When these muscle contract, they pull the tongue backward. So that is called as a retraction. So the main action of the styloglossus is retraction. And if you see the palatoglossus, you see here where the palate, soft palate is located. It is located above the tongue. So whenever the muscle contracts that arise from the soft palate, what happens? It pulls the tongue upward. So it is called as the elevation. So the palatoglossus is mainly meant for elevation. Again, I repeat, the genioglossus, the action of genioglossus is protrusion. The action of hyoglossus is depression. The action of styloglossus is retraction. And here, the palatoglossus, action of palatoglossus is elevation. Apart from that, actually, they have each muscle have accessory action also, but at least you people do remember the main action of that muscle. So now you know what is the origin of each muscle. Actually, the specific part, suppose if you say, actually, if you want, you can remember, but at least you remember the main bone where they arise from. For example, if you take hyoglossus, so it arises from the hyoid bone, I told you. Exactly where from the hyoid bone? From the greater horn and the body of the hyoid bone. Where from the styloid process? Lower part of the styloid process. Actually, you can remember this, but at least you remember the bone where they arise and the main location of these bone. That is very important. Regarding, you know, origin, insertion and action. Regarding nerve supply, don't worry. We'll discuss actually in the upcoming slides when we discuss about the nerve supply of the tongue. And one more point, this genioglossus, actually, this is one of the very important clinical point and a very important characteristic feature of the genioglossus. The genioglossus muscle is otherwise called as the safety muscle. Why it is called a safety muscle? I told you it protrudes the tongue. So it prevents the back falling of the tongue. So it keeps the tongue in position a little bit forward. So because when you lie down, when these muscles are paralyzed, what happens? The tongue falls backwards and then it goes and closes the laryngeal cavity. So that's why it is called as the safety muscle of the tongue. So what is the clinical implication of this one? So in unconscious person, the tongue may fall back and obstruct the air passage. So you have to prevent it. How? By lying the patient on one side with head down or by keeping the tongue out mechanically. Okay, so these are the very important point you should remember. And these movements already we discussed. Already told you, protrusion by the genioglossus, retraction mainly by the styloglossus, depression mainly by the hyoglossus, and elevation mainly by the styloglossus. Okay, so these are very, very important slide. Next, that's all about the muscles of the tongue. So to summarize, so the muscles of the tongue is divided into extrinsic and the intrinsic muscles. Intrinsic muscles, they are 4 in number. They origin and inserts within the tongue itself, no bony attachment. And when you talk about extrinsic muscles, definitely they have a attachment externally away from the tongue. So they are also 4 in number. And we saw what are the muscles and what are the actions they produce. Now we'll move on to the vasculature and innervation of the tongue. We'll discuss about the blood supply first. So the main artery which supply the tongue is the lingual artery. You see here, this is the lingual artery. This lingual artery arises from the external carotid artery. And after arising from the external carotid artery, this lingual artery runs deep to the hyoglossus muscle. Actually, this is the hyoglossus muscle. It runs deep to the hyoglossus muscle, where it gives rise to some branches, that is a dorsal lingual artery. This dorsal lingual artery supplies the root of the tongue. And then it emerges out of the hyoglossus muscle and then it ascends upwards and supply the body of the tongue and as well as tip. And actually, apart from these lingual artery, there are some other arteries which supply the tongue. They are the tonsillar branch of facial artery, and ascending pharyngeal artery, tonsillar branch of the facial artery and the ascending pharyngeal artery. So regarding its venous drainage, the main vein that drains the tongue is a deep lingual vein. They are the deep lingual vein. Apart from the deep lingual vein, there are other venae comitants like dorsal lingual vein and lot of other venae comitants will be there, and they all join together to form the lingual vein. So these lingual vein usually they go and drain into the internal jugular vein. So the main vein which drains the tongue is a deep lingual vein. So that's all about the vasculature, that is the arterial supply and the venous drainage. Now we move on to a very important aspect of tongue, that is innervation. The innervation is complex. Actually, we divide the innervation of the tongue into three parts. That is the motor supply and sense. Usually we will divide motor supply and the sensory supply. Here, since tongue is a very special organ, it is a sensory organ, you know. So we are dividing the sensation into general sensory and as well as the special sensory supply. We'll see one by one. Regarding the motor supply, it's very simple. All the extrinsic and the intrinsic muscles of the tongue are supplied by hypoglossal nerve. That's all. They are all supplied by the hypoglossal nerve, except palatoglossus. Except palatoglossus, that is an extrinsic muscle, which is supplied by the vagus nerve. So all the extrinsic and intrinsic muscles of the tongue are supplied by hypoglossal nerve, except palatoglossus muscle, which is supplied by the vagus nerve. Regarding sensory, first we'll see about the general sensory. So whenever we discussed about the sensory supply, it's about the dorsal surface. No, so the dorsal surface we saw, actually already we discussed, it is divided into anterior 2/3 and the posterior 1/3 of the tongue, and one more part that is there, actually that is called the posterior most part of the tongue. So what do you mean by the posterior most part? It's just the part of the tongue which is closely related to the epiglottis, still more posterior to that of the posterior 1/3 of the tongue. So that is called the posterior most part. So that's how we divide for the sensory supply of the tongue. So anterior 2/3, posterior 1/3 and the posterior most part. So each part have two sensation. One is a general sensation and taste sensation. General sensation is pain, temperature, touch, everything. And obviously taste sensation will be there. That is a special sensation. So we have to know what is a nerve that supply general sensory for that particular part, and what is a nerve that supply special sensory part. So if you take anterior 2/3, the general supply is mainly done by the lingual nerve. And the posterior 1/3, the general supply by the glossopharyngeal nerve. And the posterior most part, it is by the vagus nerve. If we take the special sensory supply, it is also very simple. Only the anterior 2/3 differs. That is, the taste sensation of anterior 2/3 is done by the caudal tympanic nerve, and the posterior 1/3 by the glossopharyngeal nerve, and the posterior most part by the vagus nerve. So when you put together, it's very simple and easy to remember. Motor supply is very simple. All the muscles of the tongue is supplied by the hypoglossal nerve, except the palatoglossus, which is supplied by the vagus nerve. That's all about the motor nerve supply. Regarding the sensory supply, we'll go by parts. It is easy for you to remember. If you take anterior 2/3, the general sensory is done by the lingual nerve and the special sensory by the caudal tympanic nerve. If you take the posterior 1/3, both the general sensory and the special sensory is done by the glossopharyngeal nerve. If you take the posterior most part of the tongue, both the general sensory and the special sensory is done by the vagus nerve. So actually the nerve supply of the tongue is a little bit complicated, but if you observe very carefully, it is very easy to remember. Why it is complicated, why there is a big difference in the nerve supply of various parts of the tongue, we'll discuss a actually it is related to the development of the tongue. Actually, it is related developmentally. We'll see in the last slide. Actually, we'll see all those things in the upcoming slides. Don't worry. So please do remember. And one more point I want to highlight here, referred pain. Usually, actually, whenever you have any issues in the posterior part of the tongue, so you will feel the pain in the ear. But if you examine the, actually, most of the patients, they complain of, sir, I have some ear pain. But if you examine the ear, you can't able to make out any pathology there. So in those conditions, please look into the posterior one third of the tongue, because the nerve supply to these middle ear and as well as this posterior one third of the tongue, they have a common nerve supply, that is the ninth nerve. So whenever you have any issues in the posterior one third of the tongue, that may be referred and it may be felt in the ear. And one more important clinical implication of this nerve supply is the hypoglossal nerve paralysis. Why it becomes very important? Because actually, what is the motor supply to the tongue we discussed? That is, all the muscles of the tongue is supplied by the hypoglossal nerve except palatoglossal. So the major nerve supply is the hypoglossal nerve. So whenever there is any hypoglossal nerve injury, how to elicit it? You ask the patient to protrude the tongue. In case of hypoglossal nerve paralysis, the tongue will be pushed to the same side. It's not opposite side. It is pushed to the same side. Actually, it's wrong. Sorry. It is pushed to the same side. Why? Why does it happen? What is the big difference here? Actually, if you take junior glossus muscle, I'll put one more slide. Actually, if you take junior glossus muscle, what is the action of junior glossus muscle? Already I told you, it is a protrusion of the tongue. That is the muscle, both the muscles act together to produce the protrusion of the tongue. So how do they act? So this is one of the very nice diagram to show the direction of action of the muscles. If you see here, the direction you see, this is the junior glossus muscle, that's how it contracts. If this is the left side for the patient and this is the right side of the patient. You see, when this muscle contracts, it moves the tongue like this in this direction. And if this side of the muscle contracts, it moves the tongue like this. So when they contract together, it protrudes out. And you imagine this is the right side muscle, and you imagine this is a paralyzed muscle. And when you ask the patient to protrude the tongue, this muscle will contract and it push the tip of the tongue towards the paralyzed side. So this is a very unique feature because it is exactly opposite. It exactly opposite in that of the facial nerve paralysis. In facial nerve paralysis, the angle of the mouth deviates towards the normal side. But here, the tip of the tongue deviates towards the paralyzed side because of the direction of action of the junior glossus muscle, opposite junior glossus muscle. So this diagram is very important to understand the concept of hypoglossal nerve injury and the deviation of the tip of the tongue in case of hypoglossal nerve injury. Next, we'll move on to the lymphatic drainage. So this is a beautiful diagram to describe the lymphatic drainage of the tongue. Actually, you see, this is the posterior one third of the tongue. Actually, here in this diagram, the tongue is divided into various parts. That is the posterior one third, along with some part of the tongue nearby the sulcus terminalis. Some part of the anterior two third of the tongue nearby the sulcus terminalis. And the tip of the tongue is divided completely. And then lateral margin of the tongue and the central part of the tongue. That's how it has been divided to understand the lymphatic drainage of the tongue. You see, I will take the tip of the tongue. The tip of the tongue is drained by the submental lymph nodes. The tip of the tongue is drained by the submental lymph nodes. Here, the lymphatics, actually some lymphatics, they cross the borders and then they go and drain bilaterally. And then if you see the lateral margin of the tongue, so the lateral margin of the tongue, they go and drain into the submandibular group of lymph nodes. So the tip of the tongue drains into the submandibular group of lymph nodes, and the lateral margin of the tongue, they go and drain into the submandibular group of lymph nodes. And if you take the central part of the tongue, the central part of the tongue, they go and drain into the deep cervical group of lymph nodes, and then they drain bilaterally. That is very, very important. The central part of the tongue, always these lymphatics go and drain into the deep cervical group of lymph nodes, inferior deep cervical group of lymph nodes bilaterally. That is very important, bilaterally. And if you take the posterior one third of the tongue, they go and drain into the superior deep cervical group of lymph nodes. And some of the lymphatics, they drain bilaterally. So the central part of the tongue, mainly they go and drain into the inferior deep cervical part of lymph nodes bilaterally. That's why whenever a carcinoma of the tongue involves the central part of the tongue, carries worst prognosis, because they go and drain bilaterally. Ultimately, all the lymphatics, they go and drain into the right venous angle. Okay, so they go and drain into the jugular vena trunk, jugular lymphatic trunk at the right venous angle. Actually, the carcinoma in posterior one third of the tongue is dangerous and is worse to prognosis than the anterior two third. Actually, that is one of the very important clinical aspects of the lymphatic drainage of the tongue, because actually, whenever you diagnose carcinoma in the posterior one third of the tongue, usually they will present to you with positive lymph nodes rather than anterior two third. Why? Because usually the posterior one third of the carcinoma of the posterior one third, they go unnoticed for a longer duration, unless otherwise they have some difficulty, unless otherwise the carcinoma grows big enough and then they interfere in deglutition and all. So usually a patient will not come to you. So usually they present to you at the late stage. That's why it carries worst prognosis than the anterior two third. And among the anterior two third, the carcinoma involving the lateral margin has comparatively less prognosis when it involves the central part also, because already told you, whenever the carcinoma involves the central part of the tongue, the lymphatic drains bilaterally, definitely it has a somewhat worse prognosis than the carcinoma that involves only the lateral margin alone. So that's all about the lymphatic drainage and its clinical implications. And these are all some of the functions of tongue. Actually, all these things we know already. So what is the main function of the tongue? That is a deglutition, taste sensation, speech production, in newborn babies, breastfeeding, self-cleansing system, and mastication. Okay, so we'll move on to the last subtopic of the tongue, that is the development, a very, very important subtopic. Actually, we can discuss a lot in detail about the development of the tongue, but for completion's sake, just I'll make it very simple. Actually, we have to know what is the development what is the origin of anterior two-third, posterior one third, and posterior most part. These are the parts of the tongue we discussed, no? When we discuss about the nerve supply of the tongue. So the anterior two third of the tongue develops from the first pharyngeal arch. Simple. So what do you mean pharyngeal arch and all, we'll discuss in a separate class. So now you just remember, the anterior two third of the tongue develops from the first pharyngeal arch. That is our brown color. And the posterior one third of the tongue develops from the third arch. Even though the second, third, and fourth arch contributes to the posterior one third of the development, but the third arch dominates, and then it mainly contributes to the development of the posterior one third of the tongue. So the anterior two third develops from the first arch, and the posterior one third develops from the third arch. And the posterior most part, it develops from the fourth arch. So these arches are very important, because actually each arch has a unique nerve supply. They have a unique nerve. Actually, each arch will have its own nerve. So whatever structure that arises from that particular arch will be supplied by that particular nerve. So the nerve of first arch, usually we call it the mandibular nerve, is the nerve of first arch. and the facial nerve is the nerve of second arch, and glossopharyngeal nerve is a nerve of third arch, and the vagus nerve is the nerve of fourth arch. So whatever structure that arises from these arches will be supplied by that particular nerve. So now you just see, since the anterior two-third of the tongue develops from the mucous membrane of the anterior two-third of the tongue develops from the first arch, so obviously it is supplied by a branch of mandibular nerve, that is a lingual nerve. That's why it is supplied by the lingual nerve. Similarly, the posterior one-third of the tongue, they develop from the third arch. What is the nerve of third arch? Glossopharyngeal nerve. That's why it is supplied by the glossopharyngeal nerve. Similarly, what is the posterior most part? Actually, it arises from the fourth arch. So what is the nerve of the fourth arch? So that is the vagus nerve. That's why it is supplied by the vagus nerve. Now you understand why the mucous membrane of the tongue, dorsal surface of the tongue, has different nerve supply. You can ask me, sir, why the anterior two-third alone has two different, all the other areas is supplied by the same nerve, both the general sensation and special sensation. But why the anterior two-third alone has a mandibular nerve? That's fine, sir. What about the caudate tympani? Actually, that is a different topic to be discussed. Just I will highlight some important point. The first arch alone has dual nerve. It has a pre-traumatic nerve and the post-traumatic nerve. That is different alone for the first arch, but all other arch have only single nerve. So the post-traumatic arch is a mandibular nerve and the pre-traumatic arch is a caudate tympani nerve. That's why the special sensation is carried away by the caudate tympani nerve and the general sensation is carried away by the mandibular nerve. If you can't able to remember all those things, you just remember the anterior two-third developed from the first arch. So it is supplied by that particular nerve of that arch. That is a mandibular nerve. That is a lingual nerve, branch of mandibular nerve. Okay, so that's all about the mucous membrane. What about the muscles? The muscles have a different origin. They arise from the occipital myotomes. You know what I mean by myotomes? Myotome are nothing but the part of somites. You know, the somite is divided into myotome, dermatome, and the sclerotome. So the myotome gives rise to muscles. These occipital myotomes gives rise to the development of muscles of the tongue. And what is the nerve of this occipital myotome? Hypoglossal nerve. That's why the occipital, that's why the muscles of the tongue is supplied by the hypoglossal nerve, because hypoglossal nerve is a nerve of occipital myotomes. Since the muscles of the tongue develops from the occipital myotomes, the motor supply to the tongue is by the hypoglossal nerve. So that's all about the development of the tongue. So to summarize, we discussed about the general features of the tongue and then muscles of the tongue, arterial supply, venous drainage, nerve supply, lymphatic drainage, and development of the tongue. So that's all about the surgical anatomy of the tongue. So please, if you have any doubts, ping me in the chat box. Definitely we'll clarify your doubts. Thank you.